And welcome to the Geeks Listen Joseph Podcast YouTube channel. This is your call. What you doing? Let me just hit that one again. What you doing? We talk about what we watch and play during the week. I'm your host, Enterprise, and I am by myself this week. I couldn't, Felix ran away. I couldn't murder. I missed it. But I can guarantee three things or a couple things. One, I'll be mumbling like a sumbitch. The other one is that I'm a loose track of what the hell I'm talking about. And the third one is that we can have some fun. So, if you enjoy this video, please forget. Don't forget. I'm already mumbling. Don't forget to leave a like, subscribe, leave a comment. What you guys been watching during this week. Maybe I watch it and shout you guys out. But enough of that. Let's get into what the hell we've been doing. Starting off with a series that I've been watching with Bubbles for the... It's been... Like, we've been chipping away at this one for a while. We basically finished it on our last hangout session. I was thinking of sex because it's called Sex Education. It's on Netflix. There's two seasons out. A couple months ago, the second season popped out. We really enjoyed the first season. I don't know, for some reason we just kept putting it. I guess we just didn't have time to get together and hang out and watch it. It is very funny. There's a bunch of hot people and there's sex every episode. So the premise revolves around this kid whose mom's is a sex therapist. But he's a teenager, so he's dealing with boners and being a virgin, etc., etc. But because he is kind of like a sponge and he is kind of learning things off of his mom without, like, subconsciously, he becomes like the sex therapist in school, and he's given all the students pointers. He has two friends. One is Maeve, Miha. She's a little Harley Quinn. Fuck, I don't have nobody to ask. So you can say Margot Robbie. She's a little Margot Robbie looking chick. I like her very much. She's cool. She's cute. She's dope. She's kind of like emo. She's kind of like tough. And then he's got also damn, I forgot his name. His other friend is a gay guy. I forget his name, but he's also dope. And he's also dealing with being like, he's like a loner gay kid, which is weird. I was going to say he's the only gay kid in school, but that's not true. There's a handful of other gay kids. But they each have their own little story and their own little backgrounds. It's really cool. But the first season revolves around about him trying to get laid and whatnot. The second season, he's jerking it more. But what I do appreciate about this series is that they actually go into detail and explain sexual things. Things that you might not. They explain sexual encounters or sexual themes in a very dope way. It got me and Bubbles arguing at one point. I won't get into that. But other characters start to come in, and then his parents are divorced and he's living with his mom. So his mom starts dating, and that's some drama coming in. The second season, there are more drama. So he basically is in love with Maeve, little Margot. But she's with another guy. So it's kind of high school bullshit, but it doesn't feel like high school bullshit. Like other shows usually feel like high school bullshit. I like this high school bullshit. She's into the swimmer guy. And they're going around and they're missing stuff. And it's high school bullshit. That's the first season. The second season is more about jerking it. And then but the end of the first season, spoiler, he's got another girlfriend. But now Maeve doesn't have one. So it's more high school bullshit. But what we didn't like about the second season, that some of the story, there's different storylines. And one of the storylines revolves around the swimmer guy, Maeve's ex-boyfriend. We didn't care much. You know, he was kind of like the High School Musical guy, where he's like, his parents are working him to the bone of being a swimmer and trying to get scholarships, but he's not into it. And then he starts to hurt himself just to not be able to compete and whatever. We just didn't care. We didn't care what happened to him. He's not part of the story, main story. They kind of branched him out. Yeah, and then he finds a friend, but there's a whole different side story that we were just not interested. It's hilarious. I love this show. It's fucking hilarious. There's a bunch of characters who are just funny. Maeve's best friend, she's a dutz, but unfortunate things and things that shouldn't happen happen to her, and she's going to a whole character crisis because it's a one, it's 100% a 180 of the way she was in the first season to the second season, and then his girlfriend, and then there's just a lot of high school bullshit, but it's done in a dope way. Also, it's British, so accents help. I very much enjoy this show. Sex Education's on Netflix. I think there's two seasons now. I'm not sure when the third one's coming out, but it's very, very, very good. Something that didn't leave me with that much good feeling is Chon Mandis's In Wonder documentary. I say question mark because I'm not sure if it's a documentary or not. I guess it's a documentary. It follows his last tour. He toured. Let me see. He was touring for 3 months. I think it was 100 shows. He does 100 shows in 3 months. That's a lot. Shawn Mendes is like a heartthrob. If you don't know who Shawn Mendes is, just in case, he's a heartthrob singer. I have a few of his songs on Spotify and that kind of stuff. I enjoy his music. Like, if we're going to go like singer dudes, he's up there for me. I like him. I like his voice. He sings pretty cool. But the documentary was kind of corny. I understand that it's probably not for me. It's most like it's geared more towards like 15-year-old girls, and I understand that. So I'm trying to take that in mind. Like, the first scene of the whole thing is like him showering and shirtless and naked, and I'm like, okay, like, you bodied up, bro, but this is not for me. I understand that, but it just feels kind of, it felt kind of corny. Cause there's voiceover him talking. I was like, oh, like, I don't want to label him a douchebag, but those were the vibes were getting me. But if I was a 15-year-old girl or whatever, I'd be, ah. One of my favorite shits ever is to see, one of the funniest things to me are girls crying over somebody. I don't get that. I don't understand that. But it's the funniest shit to me. And they're girls sobbing, screaming for this fool. I don't understand that to me. Like, it's, I just find it hilarious. I don't think they're dumb or anything. It's just something that is, I find hilarious. And I love to see girls cry over somebody, or people just cry over somebody, but just fan out like that. I find it hilarious for some reason. And it happens a couple times. So this documentary follows him for 3 months. He's talented. He's dope. The parts that I like from the documentary was when him and his element and working on music. That's the part that I like. The other part that I didn't like was the kind of dramatic parts where they're interviewing him and he's all like, you know, explaining the process, but it kind of feels scripted, and I don't know, it just doesn't feel real to me. His process is the parts that feel real when he's on stage or he's performing, so it's those parts are more real. I like those are the parts I like. We get Holmes videos as him as a kid. That was pretty cool. There's this one shot from the views from the stage to all the bulbs and all the lights he gets. He sees his point of view of the concerts and all that. It's really, really dope. The one-on-ones are kind of weird. I wasn't a fan. You can see his passion for it. It was dope. Also, the other thing that's really dope with Shawn Mendes is his girlfriend. Camila Cabello, I like her. Shout out Fifth Harmony, rest in peace. But she's dope. I like her. So they kind of talk about how they got together and whatnot, and then, you know, the songs. There's a shot of her butt real quick. I like that. I appreciate that. And I also appreciate that he closes his 100 shows in Mexico City. Shout out to Mexico. Woo! Via Mexico, whatever. But it just gave me like a kind of a corny feeling. Bubbles and I watched the Blackpink documentary that's also on Netflix. I finished that one liking the girls more than I did going in. I didn't know anything about them, really. I didn't know much about Shawn Mendes either. I knew he was Canadian. I knew that he started like on YouTube or on Vine. They touch upon that a little bit. But this documentary didn't make me like him any more or any less. I just kind of stayed level with it. The Blackpink one, like I said, I was like, oh, like these girls are dope. Like you get to know each one of them. There's more of a peek behind the curtain. There's a peek behind the curtain of the performance wise. And then there is like a very messed up part on the Shawn Mendes one where he works himself to the bone and he loses his voice and he has to cancel a show in Brazil. So that part's kind of messed up and kind of sad. That part didn't feel over dramatic or nothing. He's like crying and sobbing because he's like, that's what he loves to do, and he feels bad, and all these girls are crying, and that's like, oh shit. I haven't seen the concert. I might check it out. Like I said, I like his music. He's cool. But fandom wise, this documentary didn't move the needle for me. For Shawn Mendes, like I'll still support him. He's cool, but. It was a whatever. Something that I thought was going to be whatever, and it kind of is, but kind of not, depending on the episodes, is the We Are the Champions series on Netflix. So this is voiced over and produced by Rainn Wilson. Rainn Wilson is Dwight Schrute on The Office. And this is the documentary that covers different sports around the world. I think it's six of them. It's cheese rolling, chili eating, fantasy hairstyling, yo-yo, dog dancing, and frog jumping. The first one is cheese rolling. This takes place in England, in a little town in England. I'm not going to spoil, but the questions that I had going in is why? Why cheese rolling? Nobody knows. Everybody has different reasons as to why. It's an honor. Like, there's a whole tradition behind it. Like, it's an honor to wrap the cheese and where the cheese come from. And it's a whole big ordeal. So basically what happens in cheese rolling, they roll a barrel of cheese down the hill. You don't have to necessarily catch it, but the first person down the hill wins. That's basically it. They roll the cheese down the hill, and the first person down that same hill every year for all these tradition wins. But the way that this series is shot, they kind of follow a competitor from each episode. It gave me kind of the HBO football show vibes. Fuck, I can't remember what it's called. That I talked about before. Hard Knocks, kind of, where they follow one competitor or a handful of competitor, and they give you their backstories. So you kind of pick who you want to root for. And in the cheese rolling world, there's this like this undefeated chick who hasn't lost every time she's, and then she like gets better, but she fucked up her shoulder. They're literally throwing themselves off this hill to get to the bottom of it first. That one's pretty crazy. Without spoiling a whole lot, the chili eating, the same is this crazy guy from Fort Mill, North Carolina. Shout outs to Jordan. This is where the creator of the Carolina Reaper, if you ever heard of chilies before, this is where it originated. And he started the world championship pepper eating contest. He just looks at people on YouTube and invites them out. The way that the contest is kind of spread out, it's kind of like the Hot Ones show on YouTube. But with chiles, start with a couple jalapenos or whatever, and then there's 13 rounds of this shit, and this guy's like a mad scientist and he gets crazy. He cross pollinates normal chilies with his Carolina Reaper, so like a normal jalapeno is like a thousands or a couple twice as hot as it is because it's cross pollinate with the Carolina Reaper. And Carolina Reaper is, for now, or I don't know if it got changed or not, but as far as I remember, it was like the world record hottest pepper. I forget how many million Scovilles or whatever it is. So this fool created a 13 round contest where the Carolina Reaper is in the sixth round. After that, he pulls out these uncharted peppers that this guy has created. So these poor souls are eating all these peppers. The first thing I thought is, dude, did it get hemorrhoids? Like, that shit gotta hurt coming out. Like, you have to eat it without drinking anything. If you drink the milk, you're out. And again, they followed all these contestants and like, oh, this is the lady that she wants to be the first lady to eat the hottest pepper or whatever. And they got a lady from England. They got a guy from Napa Valley. And it's like, you following these people and you pick one, you root one, and that happens. The second one is fantasy hairstyling from this. It's international hair show. It's hairstyling. I thought this was going to be the cool one, but it was kind of like, meh. Again, they follow three contestants. They just got to do crazy hair. There's rules behind it. It was kind of whatever, this one. After that, the yo-yo, which I thought was going to be the worst one, is kind of the funny one or the cool one. Like every episode, they build up three or four contestants. And there's a yo-yo competition where they do the tricks. I know shit about yo-yo. So you might do like a normal trick and I'll be like, holy shit, these fools are doing crazy Spider-Man flips and crips. I can't tell. My eye has no idea what's going on with the yo-yo tricks, but it just looks crazy. There's a Mexican girl from Mexico. Ooh, Mexico City. Ooh, again. Ooh, Mexico. She was cool. But you just like, they kind of make you pick who you want to root for. You root for that person and then stuff happens. After that, it's dog dancing. This is in Russia. We follow the Russian team. It's pretty impressive how the dogs dance. Literally, they're dancing. Like, they know steps and choreography. That's crazy. And the last one is frog jumping. This takes place in Cali. This was the weird one where there's like teams of people going out and catching frogs. And what happens is you take a frog, you put it on the lily pad on cement, and then they measure the frog's three jumps. It sounds easy, but apparently there's some technique to get the frog to jump a certain way, and you want the fucker to go straight. So if he starts to go, or if he goes straight and then he goes turns or whatever, there's a whole thing about it. So that one's pretty interesting too, and the ending on that one surprised me. But it's a good show. It's all these six episodes. They run around 30 to 40 minutes long. I found it interesting. Rainn Wilson's voice is perfect for it, because he's kind of goofy and kind of funny, but very serious at the same time. His tone is serious. I liked it. I would like more sports for the next season, obviously. Or I wouldn't even mind if they like try to catch up on the Mexican girl, how she did in the yo-yo competition. Something that didn't leave me with the as cool or thoughtful, or I don't want any more. I'm emotionally exhausted. If I sound kind of sad or whatever, it's because I just finished watching Hillbilly Elegy. This is on Netflix. We talked about this on the pod. It stars Glenn Close, Amy Adams. I don't recognize anybody else, but everybody's performance was dope. It's directed by Ron Howard. This story is about... The trailer confused me, because I thought there was three kids. But turns out the oldest kid that I thought was the same kid, but it just jumps back in time. So this kid, as an adult, is narrating to you giving you a glimpse of his life. And he's going to Yale and he's trying to get into law school. But so that's his main mission on the movie, is to get into law school. And there's this whole crazy shit going on. He goes to an interview, like an interview dinner, and he don't think he's going to make it. And then he gets like a call back for the next day, but he needs to rush home I forget where they're at. I think they're in Ohio. No, wherever Yale is at. He has to go back to home, I think in Kentucky or Ohio, one of the two, because his mom overdosed. His mom is played by Amy Adams, and that's basically the main mission of the story, is him has to go back home and then come back before 10 o'clock before he has to have the interview the next day. In between all this, you get glimpses of his past life. His grandma is played by Glenn Close, and Amy Adams, his mama, is a mess. She's a wreck. She can't get her life in order. She goes on crazy rants, and she gets, she's like schizo, I think. There's a handful of things that's wrong, like a bunch of things that's wrong with her. She's just toxic. She's not right for her. You know, she's not a good mother and all that other stuff that comes involved with that. The performances are great. He has a sister, and then there's just like violence and toxic shit that happens in the house. Like, the mama stresses you out. Like, she's the main villain, if you want to put a villain on it. She sucks. Like, she's not cool. Everybody has somebody like this where you try to, well, maybe not everybody, but you can relate. Where you try to help them and you help them as much as you can, but at one point you just gotta let go. The movie doesn't go that route, but they are doing Glenn Close for the most part. His grandma is trying to do the best that she can because she sees that the kid is smart. He knows what he's doing, and then he gets off the tracks, but it's kind of like the mama's fault, and the mama gets like chance after chance and she keeps fucking it up, and she's jumping from boyfriend to boyfriend, and they're hillbillies. He gets called a redneck in the beginning of the movie, and he don't like that. He's all pissed. There's a cool Terminator scene with Glenn Close talking to the kid, metaphors that there's good Terminators and bad Terminators. I want to give Amy Adams props because I hated her. I really did. Like, bitch, get your shit together. Like, I was pissed at her. But that's like how good Amy Adams was, that she got me to that point of hating her. Like, bitch, you dumb. Fuck you. Like, what is wrong with you? She has chance after chance. She just stresses me out. But by far in the movie, I would give the MVP. We haven't gotten an MVP in a while. But I'll give my MVP vote to Glenn Close. Her performance was dope. They showed home videos at the end of the movie. And surprisingly enough, everybody kind of had a similar look and feel to each other, to the real people. But Glenn Close was dope. Her performance was great. I want to say Oscar, but I don't want to jinx it. Because I said Oscar before even watching another movie. And then it's like, nah, not even close. Giggity. Glenn Close. Glenn Close is my MVP. I like this movie. If you're into it's heavy. Heavy stories. Glenn Close's performance almost got me to cry. Almost. Almost. There's a point where she like, there's a scene in the car, which is dope. Which is really, really dope. Because it's just, I like this movie a lot. I didn't think I was going to enjoy it as much as I did. I thought it was going to be kind of boring and kind of whack. I was ready to be disappointed, kind of like the devil and the whatever, the Spider-Man versus Batman movie. But no, this one's way better. I want to say Glenn Close deserves a nomination. And I would even give one to Amy Adams, too. I don't know which one's supporting actress or not, but because I think the kid's the main character. But it's a very dope. I like that movie. It's very cool. So that's what I watched this week. I didn't play much, as you can see in behind me. Maybe next week we'll have a book review, and that would be really cool. Like I said in the beginning of the video, if you like the what you're doing, leave a comment down below. If you do, and if you don't, too, what can I do to change it to better make you enjoy the movie or enjoy the video a little bit more? I already fucked it up. I was doing pretty good until I started to give the outro anyway. If you haven't, go check out the podcast I did with the Friendsgiving with Felix and Bubbles. And yeah, go follow us on the socials. Bubbles is at AlexMack_211. Felix is at Jafel91. I'm at Edward Prizes, PAURAZAS. You can also follow us on the Instagram at Geeks, Flicks, and Joysticks. Yeah, drop a like, comment, subscribe, all that good shit. Y'all know what to do. Always and forever, you do you. Bye. I'm gonna pop for Bubbles. There we go. Bye.